Welcome as we gather today, and you must accept my apology for not necessarily knowing how to work the clicker as well as I like to change the screen for us today. But as we gather, let us join in our opening versicles. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Let us pray. Faithful God, most meaningful judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I invite you please to rise as we gather this day. Join in our opening songs as you are able.
Open up the door.
reading from the letter to the Romans. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. But for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of both, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Here ends that reading. The gospel reading for this day is from Matthew's gospel. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your soil? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, an enemy has done this. The slaves said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, no, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned. But gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and then they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. Here ends the readings. A friend of mine named Terry Leib tells the story about having gone to worship one day, and as he entered the church building, In the sanctuary, there were green alligators. There were humpback camels. There were chimpanzees. And there were unicorns. It was obvious that something special was going on that day, and what was special was that the kids were singing. They were singing the unicorn song. You know, the one where the words come from Shel Silverstein and the music from the Irish Rovers. And what's really fun about the song, if you're a kid, isn't just the words, but the fact that there are emotions. So you get to do green alligators and humpback camels and chimpanzees. And of course you get to do unicorns. Terry, when he tells the story, talks about a little girl who was standing right in the front of the group. And what made her stand out was the grin that truly creased her face. And the fact that while everyone else was singing the song and doing the motions, they were paying attention to the choir director. This little girl was looking out at the congregation. Oh, her alligator was truly awesome and angry. Her chimpanzees were funny, but she really, truly came to life when it was time to be the unicorn. Not only did her grin grow wide, but she was truly just the best unicorn going up there. Except when they got to the last verse of the song, and you'll remember that this is a song about Noah gathering the folks into the ark and the rain's coming, and sure enough, the last verse of it talks about the fact that the unicorns, they're still off playing their silly games. And so the ark gets loaded up and the unicorns miss the boat. She's really sad when they sing that part. But she cheers up as the congregation responds to the kids singing, and she smiles. When the service is over, Terry looks for the young girl so that she can hear that he thinks she's got Broadway in her future. When he shares that with her and her parents and siblings that overhear, the little girl smiles that beautiful smile at him again and says, "Thank you." And then Terry says, "I think you like unicorns." And she says, "Like them? I love unicorns." And she grins from ear to ear. Then she looks at Terry and says, "Did you see the movie?" To which Terry sadly explains, no, he hadn't. And the little girl is just flabbergasted that he hadn't seen the unicorn movie. Her mother, who's standing behind her, holds up four fingers to indicate that they've seen it four times. This little girl truly loves unicorns. So you can imagine there's not a whole lot of surprise, perhaps, when she begins to explain that she really likes singing the song. It's pretty cool until you get to that last verse. And she explains that it makes her sad. And she asks the question, why did God do that? Why did God do that? The unicorns didn't do anything bad. It's a pretty profound theological question for an 8-year-old. And before Terry can truly answer it, he has a flashback to his own life and his own childhood as an 8-year-old. Having heard the Noah's Ark story as a part of Vacation Bible School one particular day. And while it's a story he's heard and heard lots of times, enough to be able to tell it pretty well, he finds himself thinking not about all of the animals that got on board and all the wonders of God's saving action. What he begins to wonder about is what happened to the children who didn't get on board, who weren't a part of Noah's family. And what happened, he he thought to himself, to the puppies. For you see, Terry had a puppy at that time in his life. That little puppy was a mutt. Got into lots of trouble, but was truly a joy to Terry. And as he got to thinking about the Noah's Ark story, he got to wondering, you know, I'm not always as good as I should be. I don't think I would make it onto Noah's Ark, and I'm pretty sure my dog wouldn't either. And so out of that confusion and curiosity, he asks the teacher, what about the babies and the children and the puppy dogs? How come God didn't let them on the ark? Now, the teacher, thankfully, was used to Terry's questions, and so she did what she always did. She went right on with the lesson. But when the day was finished and class came to an end, she came to Terry and she said, I think you asked a good question. We need to ask the pastor about that. And so sure enough, the teacher passes along the question to the pastor and asks that the pastor might visit Terry. So later in the week, Terry gets a visit from the pastor. He and his mom sit in the living room to hear what the pastor has to say. And the pastor starts out by saying, it's a really good question. But the story isn't about who's left out. The story is about God's saving action. And while questions are good, we really need to pay attention and believe and trust what the Bible tells us. You can imagine there's absolute silence in that living room. And eventually, Terry's mom ushers the pastor to the kitchen door and says goodbye, and then comes back and sits down with Terry and says simply, there aren't good people and bad people. We are saints and sinners, all of us. We have good and bad in us. And questions? I think God likes questions because they tell God that we are truly listening when he speaks to us. We're truly paying attention to those Bible stories, and we've got questions and wonderings, and we're listening. Terry would go on to say later in life that that encounter with his 8-year-old self and his mother and the stories was truly a pivotal time for him, a setting up of how he would begin to know and understand who God is in his life. For you see, in the midst of the silence, after the pastor had spoken, Terry looked at him and said rather bluntly, I don't like your God. In some ways, it seems to me that's what the little girl is saying when she asks the question, why did God do that? Why did God let the unicorns not get on the ark? It's a profound question. And Terry responds to the little girl in kind, in compassion, by explaining that he too had asked similar questions at her age. And that along the way, as he wrestled with the questions that came to him, questions about God, he said, I've discovered that I don't believe that God drowned all those babies, or puppy dogs, or unicorns. And the little girl smiled and said, thank you, I don't either. And then he took a deep breath, hoping that she would not ask the next logical question, which was, where are the unicorns? Where did they go? We may not always have the answers to the questions we ask. Some of us may indeed have a whole list that we want to ask God. What I do know is that the God who made us, the God who, as the writer of the book of Romans reminds us, claims us as his children, and sets us in the world filled with hope and love, gives us an opportunity to ask questions, to wonder about who God is, to wrestle with who we are. As we gather in this time of being together and apart, I'm reminded of Jesus' parable of the wheat and the weeds. Upon first reading, we might think that Jesus is trying to tell us about who's bad and who's good, and who will get to go into the barn and who will be cast out, a bit like the story of Noah and the ark. And we're left once again with the question of, will somebody miss the boat? And will it be us? Jesus reminds us that we need simply to listen, to open our ears to hear God's voice, to open our hearts to the hope of a God who created us, who claims us as God's children, who journeys with us each day, and helps to create songs like the unicorn song, to set our feet to tapping, our grins to going from ear to ear, and our life to be celebrated. So let us live in hope, both of the things we can see and the things we cannot, a heavenly kingdom where we too get to gather in God's barn. a few announcements. So one of those announcements is that next Sunday, God willing, the creek don't rise and the weather cooperates, we'll be holding service outdoors again, up at the pavilion. So it means that you need to bring your own chair if you wish to help social distance. It means that you won't have to wear a mask if you're sitting out in the fresh air with folks who know you and love you. So please come and join us next Sunday at 11 o'clock. We'll be gathering for worship outdoors. We're going to switch to joys and sorrows. And so we're going to ask your prayers for David Emmerich. David is Ronnie and Don Emmerich's son, Michelle Gurman's brother. He spent some time in the hospital, is home from hospital, but has a number of health concerns, so please keep him in your prayers. We also want to keep Tyler and Katrina in our prayers this day. They are having some trouble with vehicles. They were on their way here this morning and it broke down, so we'll pray that things get fixed quickly. We also want to keep in our prayers, along with the folks we've been praying for the past several weeks, we want to keep in our prayers the family and friends of Kay Raring. Kay was 92 years old, or young, as it might be said. She died on Friday morning. As funeral services are being planned, they are to be limited to, my understanding is to be limited to her children and their spouses. But ask that you please would remember Kay. Some of you will have met her and known her along the way. Others of you perhaps not. She was a lovely lady who liked to read and enjoyed a good story and a good joke, a laugh along the way, and had a lovely family. So please keep them in your prayers. Are there other joys and sorrows to share? We got anything we need to share? Mr. John?
No joys or sorrows, but just to take a step backwards, after today's service, there will be a meeting for Rockin' the Hill?
Yeah. Thank you for reminding me. I'd forgotten all about it. So anyone interested in helping or being a part of planning Rockin' the Hill, please stay after church and we'll have that conversation. Other joys and sorrows that may need to be shared. Miss Sue.
Yes. So, in case anybody didn't know that, just so in parents' mom. And the other thing is, just thank you to the band for last week. I really enjoyed your music outside. It was a lot of fun, and today was exceptional as always, and I can't wait again for next Sunday. That's really great that we're doing that. I think it's really great that we're outside. I think a lot of people really had a good time last week. I know the count was a little bit up, but it was just really nice just being out and on.
The band gets a huge thank you from me today for playing in heat and humidity.
Yeah.
So thank you for weathering the heat and the humidity and sounding good in the process.
Yeah, and the person who really gets the credit for last Sunday is Sean.
Yeah.
Sean puts a ton of work in and he deserves a round of applause. Very early on when we first came here, there was always a question, why are we paying for somebody to do Santa? Why are we paying? This is why. You know, all the stuff this guy does is a lot.
Thank you, Sean.
And
thank
very
you.
Much worth every penny the guy gets. So.
And then some. Mr. DeFalco, because I can't remember your first name at the moment.
I wanted to mention that there was a veteran in my program that was in need this week due to the COVID-19 issues. I talked to the pastor and some arrangements were made to help those veterans. So I just wanted to present that to the church, that we are helping outside the church. And that was at a moment's notice, so I appreciate that.
We do our best to help when we are made aware of a particular thing, and so glad we were able to do that. Other joys and sorrows for this day? And I invite you please to join me in a prayer. Lord of green alligators and humpty-backed camels, of chimpanzees and elephants and unicorns, we give thanks for this day and for your creation. We ask that you would watch over all those who are traveling from place to place, be it for work or for joy, or just for the heck of it because it's nice to be out traveling. Make those journeys safe and homecomings joyful. We pray for our world, Lord, for its leaders, and ask that you would let your spirit guide them, be the solid rock that they can stand on. As we hope for things we cannot see, we ask your blessing upon all those whom we have named this day, aloud or in our hearts. Continue to watch over and grant your healing touch to all who call upon you. As we remember your servant, Kay Rearing, we give thanks for her life. We commend her into your care and keeping, trusting the promise that you have made to us as your children, that we get to enter your heavenly kingdom. Grant comfort and hope to her family and friends. Grant to those things, Lord, which you know we need. And help us to pray each day, as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep our hearts and minds in Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to rise as you are able and join in our closing songs.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, for we come, we're gathered together. Lift up your name, call on our Savior, fall on your grace. In the name of the Father, in the name of the
Oh.